A very good afternoon to all of you who have joined with us today in this webinar. Hope you are all in the pink of your health and are safe during this lockdown period. I, Ebenezer Wilson Rajkumar, working as Senior Occupational Therapist in IPH, would like to use this platform to outline the various postural and oromotor difficulties faced by children with cerebral palsy and the correct techniques to rehabilitate them. By the end of this webinar, I think you will be able to use the proper posture and seating techniques used in the oromotor rehabilitation of children with cerebral palsy safely in your home. Before going into the presentation to see what are the various posture and seating techniques, I would like you to revisit a few definitions. We all must be knowing the definitions of cerebral palsy, posture and postural control. Anyhow, for a better understanding, cerebral palsy is defined as a disorder of movement and posture that is caused by a non-progressive lesion that occurs in utero, during or shortly after birth, and is expressed through variable impairments in the coordination of muscle, action and sensation. What is posture? Posture is defined as the attitude assumed by the body either when the body is stationary or when it is moving. Postural control. The continuous adaptation of the body posture necessary for the execution of functional activities are generated by complex interactions of musculoskeletal and neuronal systems and is defined as postural control. In this slide, we will see the complex interaction of the musculoskeletal and the neuronal systems. There are two types of control which take place to maintain a particular posture. One is the feedback control and one is the feed-forward control. In the feed-forward control, the motor cortex sends a command for voluntary movement which gives anticipatory adjustment to the destabilizing effect of voluntary movement, which leads to correction of the body orientation. Whereas the motor cortex also directly controls the body orientation. The body orientation, once when it is changed, gives vestibular, visual and somatosensory feedback, which again is processed and integrated. This informed body orientation is given to the comparator, and the desirable body orientation and the corrective command is given to correct the body posture. Moving on, we would see what are the goals of positioning. Children with cerebral palsy need external support in different positions with the aim of enabling them to experience and develop normal ways of moving and preventing secondary complications. Based on clinical and research evidence, it is widely accepted and common practice for general goals of seating and positioning to include normalizing tone or decreasing its abnormal influence, maintaining the skeletal alignment, preventing or accommodating skeletal deformity, providing a stable base of support to promote function, promoting increased tolerance of the desired position, promoting comfort and relaxation, facilitating normal movement patterns or controlling abnormal movement patterns, managing pressure or preventing the development of pressure sores, decreasing fatigue, enhancing autonomic nervous system functions like cardiac, digestive and respiratory functions, facilitating maximum function with minimum pathology. Some basic principles of good positioning include: symmetry and alignment should be respected as much as possible in all the positions. 2. The child should feel comfortable. At first, the child may not like a new position, but if he continues to show discomfort, probably he requires some preparation before placing him in the position, either loosen or normalize the tone, or there should be some positional adjustment, even if this means compromising partially on the ideal position. Parents should be discouraged in forcing the child in a position if the child feels uncomfortable. 3. The position should enable the child to experience more normal patterns of movements. Example, good proximal stability of the trunk in sitting promotes selective movements of the upper extremity for playing, writing, eating, etc. 4. The position should be varied and changed frequently. If you do not change the position frequently, it may lead to pressure areas and it may lead to stiffness and contracture. It also does not allow the child to experience movement in different positions. Having understood the mechanism of postural regulation and the importance of positioning, let us look at what are the difficulties faced by a CP child and how to correct them. If the child exhibits a global pattern of extension, it may be helpful to put him into a more bent or more flexed symmetrical position. This might help such a child to look and use two hands for a task placed in front of him. For example, when you look at the picture, the first picture shows a child lying on its back on a flat surface. So he pushes back, head to his towards one side, one arm and the legs are bent, the other arm and... In the first picture, you can see the child exhibiting ATNR symptoms and is placed on a flat surface. It is not correct to place the child in a flat surface. It is better to place the child in a reclining surface with the hip and knees bent. The next figure shows a cerebral palsy child being placed in a wheelchair. You can see that there is a complete extension of the body. So we can control this by giving straps and by placing a wedge in between the knees and foot straps to control the knee extension. So this is the proper posture. If the child is habitually exhibiting abnormally bent or flexed position, it may be helpful to put the child into a straighter or more extended symmetrical or high kneeling position. Again, this might help such a child to use the eyes and two hands for the task. Have a look at these pictures. In the first picture, the child shows an abnormal bent position during sitting. In order to correct it, we can put the child in a prone position and strapping the hip so that the child can use her hands and eyes for activities. In the next picture, you can see the child being placed in a wrong position on the wheelchair. You can make the patient adapt a straighter position or make the patient stand with the help of gaiters and body support. In the third picture, you can find a child exhibiting W sitting posture and bent posture. To correct that, you can put the child in high kneeling position and by placing a stool in front and giving activity so that the child can concentrate on doing all these activities. Various equipments are provided for positioning a cerebral palsy child. The type of equipment which we choose to provide should depend on the child's age, the specific pattern of posture and movement, the child's stage of development, and deformities whether present or not. If the child is predominantly in a lying position, you have to alternate between different positions, that is, alternate between side lying, supine, and prone positions so that pressure source and body stiffness will not arise. The prone position is especially good to develop control of the shoulder, arms and hands, and also stretches the muscles of the hips, knees and shoulder. The different equipments which can be given are the cushion, wedges, foam rolls and towels, as you can see in the picture. The next is sitting position. The sitting position becomes a truly functional position for play when a child is about 8 to 9 months old. A typical child has good trunk control, balance in sitting and hip mobility, and does not rely on the hands for support and can reach out in any direction to get toys and develop in-hand manipulative skills. We should not wait, as some CP children never attain independent sitting. Choose the right basic chair. Primarily, a seating system should ensure a stable postural base. The position of pelvis is an important factor. Postural control and alignment and postural head control. The different types of chairs are pushchairs, strollers. It depends upon the abilities and the problem of the child. In this slide, you can find pictures of various cerebral palsy chairs, wheelchairs, corner chairs, and box chairs to provide proper sitting position. Next, standing position. Children unable to stand on their own benefit socially from being upright. Unsupported cerebral palsy children stand with their ankles plantar flexed, semi-flexed knees, internally rotated and adducted hips. Support is needed to control this posture and provide a secure base. In some children, standing frames may be ideal. In common with any support system, they can be restrictive, but typically prevent the inefficient posture, give a good stretch to the hip adductors, allow weight bearing, and give a change from the sitting position. The standing position also contributes to the development of hip joint. It prevents the risk and dislocation and pain. It increases the density of bone because decreased density of the bone may lead to fractures. It increases the breathing and blood circulation. It helps in emptying bladder and bowel. It reduces the stiffness, tone, and uncontrolled movements. In this slide, you can find the child on the left is standing with the knees bent and the ankles plantar flexed and the trunk bent, and the child uses his hands to stabilize himself. But whereas on the right, you can find that when the child is placed in a standing frame, the child is free to use his hands for play. These are the advantages of standing position. Moving on to the oromotor aspect of cerebral palsy children. Children with cerebral palsy exhibit a variety of oromotor impairments that lead to difficulty in speech, swallowing, and communication. Oromotor functioning depends on an intricate process of sending and receiving messages to various facial, throat, and neck muscles to coordinate breathing, talking, chewing, swallowing, and digestion. Before looking at what are the oromotor problems or difficulties faced by the cerebral palsy child, we should have a look at the reflexes which play a major role in helping the child to suck, swallow, bite, chew, etc. What are reflexes? Reflexes are involuntary movements or action. Why do we check reflex? We check reflex to determine whether the brain and the nervous system are working well and in coordination with each other. Some reflexes occur only in specific periods of development. So now let's see what are the oral reflexes which play a major role in the development of a typical child. The first reflex is your rooting reflex. The rooting reflex is present from 0 to 3 months. How will you check it? When you strike the outside corner of the lips or cheeks, the child turns the head towards the stimulus. How is this helpful? This helps the child in searching. The next reflex which you are going to see is a tongue thrust. It is present from 0 to 4 months to 6 months of age. When we introduce a food or liquid, the tongue comes forward to the front of the teeth. The next reflex is the gag reflex. It is present from 0 to adulthood. When you give a pressure on the back of the tongue, the object is propelled forward on the tongue. The next reflex is the Babkin reflex. It is pressure when you give pressure on both arms of the palms of the infant, the mouth of the infant opens. Oromotor difficulties faced by children with cerebral palsy: delayed speech and language development, dysarthria, also called as motor speech disorder, which may be due to poor muscle tone and lack of coordination of facial, neck, and throat muscles. Difficulty in articulating sounds correctly due to weakness or spasticity. Difficulty in blowing, sucking, chewing, biting, swallowing, and non-vegetative functions like speech. Last, inappropriate oral sensory awareness, which leads to trunk thrust and drooling. Rehabilitation of oromotor dysfunction. Severe spastic quadriplegia and dyskinetic patients, you will find they have more feeding problems. Spastic hemiplegia may be physically able to manage the feeding but are often asymmetrical in their actions. Now, how to correct them? First of all, you should have an unhurried feeding period. How can this be done? First, you give time for a relationship to develop and for a child to respond being fed. That is, a rapport should be developed between the mother and child. Next, giving adequate time for the child to accept new tastes and textures. If you do not provide this time, the child may be not able to accept the new texture or shape. Then the speed of your feeding should be slow. Remember that making demands on self-feeding may compromise on the oromotor scales of the child and should not be at the expense of intake or safety. One-to-one sessions. On one-to-one sessions for the child and parent, the therapist settles them in a quiet, undisturbed area to avoid any distractions. Positioning for feeding. Involve an upright position, supported or if possible unsupported by special chairs or by the parent. See, a wrong posture is do not feed the baby while she is lying on her back. The right position is feed the baby in a half sitting position with the head bent slightly forward. The picture on the left shows a wrong position to feed the child, as this may choke the child. Once the bottle is above the child, you will not be able to control the flow of the liquid, hence there will be choking or aspiration. So the proper position is position the baby so that the head is slightly forward and the bottle comes from in front and not above. Pushing gently on the chest helps stop backward stiffening so that the baby can swallow better. If possible, have the baby hold the bottle.
The child's head should be held by you or when possible by himself in a forward, chin in an upright position while taking food, during eating, drinking, especially on swallowing. Swallowing with the head back is more difficult and increases the risk of aspiration. What is aspiration? It is the entry of food or fluid in the airway. If the child's head is up, it not only protects the airway but also allows active learning of eating and drinking. Gently press a child's chest to help the head come forward and up, and if the head drops down, give minimal support under his chin. Elbows on the table are also recommended, as you can see in the picture. Leaning on a table activates the shoulder girdle stabilization and assists head stability. There is control of hand to mouth action as the elbow is steadied by the arms on the table. Chairs which can be used for promoting feeding in cerebral palsy children. There are different types of chairs which can be used, and it is pertinent of the therapist to determine what type of chair is needed. Either you can provide a high chair with one or two straps as shown in the figure. We can use any number of straps either in the abdomen or in the chest. Otherwise, you can provide a cardboard box seat so that the child is completely protected while feeding. Some children with cerebral palsy may only need a foot strap to stay in a good position, as seen in the picture. In this slide, you can see how the head extension and tongue thrust interferes with drinking and eating. So, in order to correct that, holding the child's head upright and forward, supporting a chin and stroking under the jaw trains the child in drinking. Then, waiting for the child to remove food from the spoon held below her mouth. Keep her head and shoulders well forward as she takes the food. This will help in correcting the tongue thrust and head extension while drinking and feeding. Next, suck, swallow or chew takes a lot of coordination of the mouth, jaw and throat. A cerebral palsy child may have trouble with this coordination and therefore with one or all of these skills. If a child has a weak suck, she tires easily while feeding and takes a long time to finish her feeding. How can you find out if the child has a weak suck? The nipple can be easily removed from the mouth and there is not an easy flow or rhythm to the sucking pattern. You can develop a stronger sucking motion by making sure the child is dry, warm and rested before feeding, supporting the jaw if necessary, and be sure the lips are closed around the nipple. You can also try different nipples of shapes, sizes and a softer nipple also. Do not try to poke a larger hole in the nipple because it makes the flow very fast and it will lead to choking. You can also try cuddling the child if you can and talking to her as you feed her. Next, the child who has no sucking or swallowing reflex, the feeding should be taught with a spoon. So we'll see what are the correct and wrong postures in feeding with the spoon. The wrong postures are, you should not feed the child from the side or from the above. Always try to give the spoon from in front of the patient. We will see what is the best spoon which is used to feed a child. The best spoon is, it should be rounded and shallow. The spoon should not be deep as it is very difficult for the child to get the food out of the spoon. And the spoon should not be also long and pointed as this could cause choking or aspiration in the child. In this picture, you can find that feeding a child from above will lead to tongue thrust. So, applying firm pressure on the tongue and if you have jaw control, it helps prevent tongue thrust. If spoon feeding is too difficult, then use your fingers to feed the child. To promote drinking, select a cup which has a projecting rim. Then on the opposite side, cut out a space to fit around the child's nose when the child lifts the cup to drink water. Position the child in a sitting position with the trunk slightly bent so that the child will be able to drink in a much more better way and in a controlled position. Position of the parent or caregiver during feeding. If sitting on a chair, couch or bed to feed, you have to make sure that you are comfortable with a cushion behind your back and another under your supporting elbow. Keep your upper arm firmly against the top of her head and not behind the back. Make sure you can see your elbow while you are doing this. Hold the child's bottoms firmly between your legs so that the child does not push back during feeding. Support the knees with one leg and the back with the other. Raise the leg that is supporting our back by putting something under your foot to make the back straight. Then bring her arms forward so that the shoulders also come forward. You can see in the picture the proper position of the parent or caregiver during feeding. If you are sitting on the floor, then what is the proper position to feed the child? Try to sit with your back against a wall to rest your back. Keep your upper arm firmly against the top of the child's head and not behind the neck of the child. Make sure you can see your elbow while doing this. Then put a cushion under your raised knee to keep yourself comfortable and to keep the back of the child straight. Make sure your child's bottom is well between your legs so that you can keep her hips firmly bent. For the bigger child or for the one who pushes back very strong, try resting her bottom firmly on the floor and then push your legs up towards her chest. Place your leg firmly across her feet to hold them flat on the floor. To promote mouth actions, what should we do? In taking the food, keeping the mouth closed during eating, chewing actions and swallowing can be facilitated by your hands supporting under the chin. Fingers may be held above and below his lips to stimulate mouth closure. Simply achieving mouth closure may lead to spontaneous swallowing. There are two ways of doing this. One is sitting beside the patient and another is sitting in front of the patient. If you sit beside the patient, your thumb is on the jaw joint, your index finger is at the lips and your middle finger is in the chin. So what you do is you close the mouth with your index finger, you then manipulate the jaw joint and then you use your middle finger to enhance swallowing by striking under the chin. So this procedure can also be done by sitting in front of the patient. When you sit in front of the patient, then the position of the hand changes. Your thumb is closing the lips, your index finger is manipulating the jaw joint and the middle finger is stroking the chin. Weaning. How will you wean a CP child? You start from liquids and make them tolerate various textures of liquids. Then you make them taste through semi-solids and then progress to solids. This is the most important aspect of weaning. Then you should also note there are some textures which may cause problems to a CP child. What are those? Some children may have trouble swallowing thin liquid, so you will need to thicken the liquid. The thickened texture makes it easier to swallow because the liquid moves more slowly from the mouth to the throat, giving the child more time to swallow. The child may have trouble swallowing dry or lumpy foods. Give her pureed foods such as applesauce, cranberry sauce or pureed fruits or vegetables in between bites of the dry or lumpy food, or use them as a dip for the dried food. Multi-textured foods that involve thin liquid and solid such as soups can be difficult to swallow. Foods that do not dissolve such as raw fruits and vegetables can also be difficult for the child to swallow. Gagging or choking. The common causes of gagging in a child are: offering the wrong texture can cause gagging and choking. Offering new textures may also cause gagging. Introduce new textures gradually to build up tolerance of new foods. Gagging may be a warning for you to be careful with the techniques you are using, such as placing the spoon too far back on the tongue, or slow down the pace of the feeding, or put smaller amounts of food in the spoon. Gagging may also be a behavioral response. It could be an emotional reaction from a negative experiences such as tube feedings, a way to get attention, or a form of temper tantrum. Positioning of the child can also affect swallowing. When gag and choking occur in other children without reflex, calmly and quickly tip the child forward and down. Avoid banging him on the back. There are also other ways of feeding a CP child. They are gastrostomy and nasogastric tube. What are those? Nasogastric tube. It is a food route which runs from the nose to the stomach. Its use is recommended when it is anticipated that the need to contribute by this route will not be more than 4 to 6 weeks in duration and there is no gastroesophageal reflex. So if you think that the child is going to require more time other than 4 to 6 weeks, then you have to go through the gastrostomy. What is gastrostomy? It is a food route that goes directly to the stomach. It is implanted when the oral route is not used in a prolonged way, that is beyond 4 to 6 weeks. The advantages of a gastrostomy are that with this food route, it is easier to handle at home and there are fewer risks of injury to nose or throat. And the main thing allows the incorporation of more food in comparison to the nasogastric tube. Training self-feeding. How to train a child to self-feed? Let her elbow rest on the table if it gives her more control. Then you can also lift the table up on the blocks to bring the bowl of food closer to her mouth, which will also give her more control to feed herself. If you find the child is having difficulty in holding a cup with one hand, then you can try using a cup which has two handles. If the spoon slips out of the child's hand, then you can use a rubber tube so that the spoon does not slip out of the child's hands. If the grasp or grip of the child is weak, then you can use a piece of wood around the handle of the spoon and bend the neck of the spoon so that it fits the child's grip. If there is difficulty in flexion and extension of the wrist, then you can use an arm rocker board for the child to improve self-feeding. I would like to thank the director of PDU-NIPPD, Mrs. Smita Jaywant, for her efforts in conducting this webinar, her support and guidance throughout this webinar. I also thank my HOD of OT department, who has been a big source of encouragement throughout my career. I would also like to convey my regards to Mr. Anup Sharma, computer expert, for coordinating with this webinar. Last but not the least, I would also like to thank all the audience for their patient listening. Thank you.